Literary Festival. You are attending the 8th event, Cultivating the Storycraft, held in Bookworm Suzhou. My name is Vinci, and it's my honor to be your moderator today. And this is our interpreter, Helen. 各位亲爱的读者朋友们，大家下午好，欢迎大家来到第二届中欧文学节的现场。今天是咱们苏州场的第八次活动，讲故事技巧的培养。我是 Vinci， 很荣幸成为本场的主持人，欢迎大家的到来。这位是我们今天的翻译 Helen， 欢迎大家。是什么让一个故事新鲜、生动和难忘？如何构建鲜明的人物形象和真实的对话场景来推动故事的发展？在保证开头不透露太多情节的时候，怎样吸引读者一同踏上文学之旅？本场活动中，四位人气作家将和我们一起讨论他们作品中的叙事线索和框架结构。
What makes a story fresh, vivid, and memorable? How to develop strong characters and present authentic dialogues that can guide and drive the plots? And how can a driver most successfully invite the readers to enjoy the literary journey without divulging too much at the very beginning? So in this session, our four acclaimed writers will discuss the way they develop their narratives and how they construct solid story frameworks. So first of all, I would like to introduce them.
首先让我来为大家做一个四位作家的简短的介绍。首先是来自中国上海的我们的朱文莹老师，他是苏州作家协会副主席，曾经被评为首届年度青年小说家，作品在国内和海外享有高度声誉，部分作品被收藏于法国国家图书馆。欢迎你，朱老师。
Zhu Wenying from Shanghai, Vice Chairwoman of Suzhou Writers Association, whose novels have been introduced into many countries, and some of her work have been collected in French library.
来自保加利亚的 Svet Di Nahum 先生，保加利亚写作中心作家和出版社协会秘书会成员，长短篇小说家，作品曾被译介到多个国家。
Mr. Svet Di Nahum, member of Bulgarian Union Writers, whose work has been translated into several different languages.
来自捷克共和国的 Halina Pawlowská, 舞台电视撰稿人，短篇小说家，曾经做过电视节目主持，担任过多家报刊杂志的记者、专栏作家和编辑。
Mr. Halina Pawlowská, famous short story writer from the Czech Republic.She has served as a screenwriter of various TV programs, as well as columnist, editor of various journals and newspapers.
来自中国湖北的黄范先生，南京评论主编，两岸诗总编，其诗歌在台湾地区广受欢迎，曾获多项国内国际大奖。
Mr. Huang Fan from Hubei, China, editor of Nanjing Review, who has received lots of awards for poetry and fiction. His work has been very well received in Taiwan and mainland China.
好的，现在开始我们的提问环节。然后我的第一个问题是，想问问四位作家，一个故事最重要的因素是什么？是什么让一个故事生动、有趣、令人印象深刻？首先，我们把话筒交给我们的朱文莹老师。
So now my first question goes to all of you. So what is the most important factor for a story, and what makes the story memorable and impressive?
首先我觉得这个活动的主题对我来说，怎么来讲故事？其实我不是一个擅长讲故事的作家。从我的刚开始的写作开始，我的小说就不是从讲故事开始的。
Well, the topic for today's section is about telling stories. Well, I myself, I'm not really good at telling stories because my novels does not start from stories.
我会觉得，这个问题有两个方面。我一直觉得最好的小说它应该是达到一个寓言的一个状态，它就是说应该穿越。故事的本身来到它的另一个层面。
I think there are two parts to this topic about telling stories. I think the best stories are like a fable in that it goes beyond time and space and then to a higher level.
故事本身它其实包括了它的故事框架和故事本身它应该具有的精神层面的两方面。这也是为什么有些通俗小说作家，我觉得他没有能够达到那个层面以后，他就是我觉得与另外的一些作家 会区别开来的一个特别重要的原因。
I think story actually includes the frame of the story and the spirit of the stories. Those are the two important levels to a story. I think for some popular story lists, they cannot achieve those two stories. And those that's why how they cannot set themselves apart from other great story lists.
当然我认为这个活动的题目其实肯定不是在探讨我们怎么讲故事的一个技巧，这不是一个小说技巧的一个讨论会，所以我先把这个话题，然后大家先展开来，然后我们进入下面一个层面。
So I think the topic of this session is not about the techniques per se of telling stories. So I would like to hear more expansion from our other writers and keep discussing this.
Thank you for being with all of us here tonight. I'm really glad that this event is happening because it's part of the growing partnership between the European Union and China.
首先想感谢大家的到来，参加我们今天的中欧国际文化节。那我想这也是中国和欧洲不断加深合作的一个见证。
The good thing about literature is that it is universal and it's for everybody. It's not some snobbish sport like playing golf. And for example, when the great novelist Mo Yan came to Bulgaria, he shared with us that at the time he was a student in the school, he was reading Bulgarian short fiction and short stories and from our writers, and he was learning a lot from this. So this is an example how important literature is for the people everywhere.
那其实文学它是一个非常普世性的一种追求，它并不像高尔夫这样略带虚荣感的一些游戏一样。那就正如莫言，中国的作家莫言之前来到保加利亚的时候呢，他也会提到他当时还是一名学生的时候就阅读很多保加利亚短篇小说，也从中学到了很多。这也体现到文学的一个重要性。
Right now in the modern era, there are like so many techniques which they are popularizing on the internet space. They even have outlined some software for writing novels, for writing scripts for TV, for feature films, and it is like a matrix for writing.
那其实说到小说，其实，在当代这个互联网的时代，甚至现在互联网上有很多一些模板，关于写小说的一些模板，或者是针对编剧、针对电影写作的一些模板。But
even because many software engineers think that they can construct literature, that's why because it is not happening, because literature is something different from, let's say, mathematics or computer science.
但是呢，其实这个文学呢，它和这个数学和科学不一样，它是并不能够用软件来构造的。Because
literature is too much different from science. It is something which is still unexplainable, and at the same time it's very vivid, and it's part of everybody. It doesn't matter whether you are a writer or a reader, because even when you are a reader, you still create when you read.
所以文学它其实并不同于科学，它是无法解释的，它是有生命力的，它是每个人的一部分，不管你是作家还是读者，即使你是读者，你在读的阅读的时候也是在创作。
So that is my point. I don't believe in this matrix or software for writing. I believe in spontaneous inspiration. And that is how the story just comes either from real life or from somewhere. It could be real one, it could be fictional one. But this happens when you are sensitive to everything which surrounds you.
所以我觉得文学它并不是能够通过软件所构造的，它是来自于一种持续不断的一种灵感，它是来自于生活，不管是真实的还是虚构的，这需要你非常的敏感，能够捕捉把握到你周围的一切。
And that is how inevitably something has been accumulated in your heart, in your soul, in your mind. And when time passes on, suddenly when all this comes together, then you have the good story.
所以说对于文学来讲，这其实是来自你一个，来自你的心灵，来自你头脑，来自你灵魂中长时间积累之后的一个爆发。
And of course there are rules, of course there are techniques. It's one thing to start a script, for example, for the TV or for the feature film. It's one thing to start a script with a wedding, and it's different thing to start with funeral.
那其实所以说，当然它也是有一些规则，也有一些技巧。你自然，你像你给电影写剧本，你给电视写台词，又或者是你给婚礼致辞，或者是葬礼致辞，那都是有些不同的规则和技巧的。And
when you believe in your creativity, even if you break the rules, you still be okay, and you will have a successful story.
所以只要你去相信你的创意，哪怕你打破了规则，你仍然能写到一个优质的小说。
Okay. Okay, hello, hello. I have special role now here because Svet will tell everything, and I will tell you yes, he's right. Exact. So that's true. No. What's about me? I'm writing funny novels, funny movies, and short story. So I will be short, very short. And I will tell only about my experiences with writing. Story, and I think that.
那其实我在told
everything.
其实我坐在 Svet 旁边，我有一个特殊的角色，就是每次在 Svet 讲完之后，我都要对他表示同意，我都要点头，我要说是。 那我本身呢，除了我会写这个写小说，我也会写电影剧本，我还会写一些这个其他的有趣的一些故事。 那我今天呢也会尽量的保持简短，我会讲一下我个人的一些经历。So
for me, three things are most important. A hero, who the reader finds captivating.
那其实对我来讲有三点是特别重要的，首先就是主角，我希望我的读者能够觉得我的主角非常的迷人，引人入胜。
Now I will be a little bit poetic, because the second very important thing is words that flow like flowers on the surface of a lake.
那我想第二点，第二个元素啊，就是词汇。那如果用一种非常诗意的方方法来表达词汇的重要性的话，那就是词汇就像在湖面上漂流的花朵一样。And
the third thing, storyline. That it is discreetly hidden yet at the same time crystal clear.
那第三点呢，就是剧情，那它似乎隐藏在这个故事之中，但是同时又是非常的清晰。
Thank you.
其实刚才那个朱文颖也提到了，就是说，其实到我们这一代作家在写小说。 不会说仅仅是贡献于一个传统的故事啊，有些如果我们是19世纪的人，可能会去考虑故事的完整性，考虑故事的这种表述中间的很多规则啊。其实到了20世纪现代小说，我觉得一个最重要的就是它，这种诗意啊，诗意在小说中间的一种渗透，还有这种隐喻的这种一种在小说中间的一种泛化。
Earlier, Ms. Zhu Wenying mentioned that for
novelist of our generation, to write novels is no longer to contribute to tradition, to the traditions of novels. Because if we were in 19th century, we care a lot about the wholeness of the story, the rules of expression when telling a story, but we are now in the 20th century and it's a modern literature age, and we care the sense of being poetic and metaphor and now penetrate into telling story.
当故事不具有完整性的时候，如何又保持小说本身的魅力？那对我来讲的话呢，我主要是考虑虚构一个真实的情景。为什么会这么做？因为我个人有一个看法，人是环境的奴隶，人是环境中间的小白鼠，在不同的环境下，人的人性反应和情感是不一样的。
So without the wholeness of story that's represented in the 19th century, so how can we keep story intriguing? For me, it's to make up a real situation, because I think people are slave to environment, and under different circumstances, people's responsive and emotions are different.
所以我也是从故事的角度去看待不同的社会系统，比方说各个国家、各个民族，我把它看成是一个 类似于小说这样的一个环境，因为这样的不同的环境下，我们人性的表现、情感的表现形式都是不一样的。那么小说其实就相当于是一个纸上的国度。
So for me, I'm looking at different society, different social system, from the movie's perspective, because I think the society is like the environment that I made up, and the novels is like society on the paper.
所以呢，我的小说的构成单元就是情境，所以我用一些若干情境，我觉得就可以代替一个故事。 它是一个不完整的故事，但是呢，它在表现人物方面，我觉得它和故事同样的具有一种魅力。那这也是我因为自己可能写诗的原因，我在情境中间我可以很好的把这样一个故事诗化，把人物的这种情感，某些情感诗化。那这样一种表现呢，我个人觉得，赋予了这样一种情境，类似于故事一样的那样一种力量。
So for me, the elements of my stories are different situations. I think several different situations constitute a story. And I also write poet. And I think that I made different situation, different emotions of people poetic.
找到一个结局，然后我从任何一个地方开始，这样既可以隐藏，开头的意图，使读者并不知道小说会向哪个方向发展，但是就像做这个数学题一样，就由开头一直导向结局，你会发现，写完以后你会发现，非常的严丝合缝，好像你在之前已经经过预先的设计一样，其实在这中间有很多随机的一种想象。
So when I write short story, I usually find the ending that I want first, and then I will start at anywhere. So in that way, I can hide my original intention, but the leaders will, but it will lead to the end. So it all looks like seamlessly workable, but there is still a sense of randomness in between.
That's all.
好的，然后我的第二个问题就是，因为我之前也读过就是四位作家的一些作品节选，然后我发现他们有一个共同的特点，就是在描写人物的心理活动上都非常的细致，而且非常熟练，所以想问一问四位作家，可以跟我们谈谈，你们是在写作过程中怎么样抓住一个想象中的人物的微妙的感情，并且将它转化为故事细节的吗？
谢谢，我会觉得今天的这里很漂亮的主持人，他很像一个
突然想起我小学时候的语文老师，然后说坐在当中的这个你站起来，然后你就回答，就是他很严肃的问我们很多很多的问题。
So my second question is that I have read some of the works from the writers present here today, and I find out that they are all very proficient in depicting the psychological status in their novel. So my question is that how can you capture the subtlety in their psychology and make it in story detail? And also, our host, our moderator today is very pretty, and she reminds me of my Chinese teacher in elementary school who asks serious questions to us.
其实我觉得小说和作家本身，甚至文学，其实都有非常神秘的一个核心。当作家他写作到一定的经验以后， 当他一个小说开始的时候，他会很清楚的知道这个是一个短篇小说，或者他会发展成一个中篇小说，或者还有可能他其实是一个长篇小说。有的人可能一开始觉得这是一个短篇，但是当他写到可能2000字的时候，他会很清晰的知道我手里其实在进行的可能是一个长篇的一个框架。
Well, actually, to novelist, writer, or to literature in general, there is a very mysterious core. I think that with years of experience, the writer would know that what they are writing would be a short story or novelette or even novel. So at the very beginning, maybe you assume that it would be a short story, but after writing for 2,000 words, you know for sure that it could be a long story or a novel.
作家本身的特质其实也在决定着他是怎么写小说的。其实一个作家能不能讲故事，他用哪种方式讲故事，他会更倾向于一种写实性的风格，或者还是他天生的会用进入人物心理的方式，这种潜意识的方式。 写小说都是和这个作家本身是谁是密切相关的。即使你有时候想改变他，想改造他，但是你走了一长段路以后，你其实发现，你还是不由自主的，或者说是被迫的，或者说非常痛苦的回到了你的本身，你没有办法改变你自己。So
actually the writer, who they are, decides how they write, whether you can tell a story or not, or the way that you tell a story, whether it is realistic, or how you get into the subconsciousness of a character, it all depends on who you are. Sometimes you want to change the way you tell the story, but after a long struggle, maybe you realize that you always have to go back to who you are and write the way it is.
就是我为什么那么强烈的在解释这些东西，因为其实还是回到原点，我不是一个很擅长讲故事的作家。The
reason that I explain this is that just as I mentioned at the very beginning that I'm not very good at telling stories.
但与此同时，我特别同意我一位评论家朋友说的一句话，他说，你作为一个作家，作为一个小说家，你可以选择不讲故事。 但是你不能不会讲故事，其实还是很有意思的。But
meanwhile, one of my friend who is a critic says that if you are a writer or a novelist, you can choose not to tell stories, but you shall be able to write stories.
就像那个毕加索在他的后期，他创作了很多，可能就是特别有意义这种抽象主义的。 这种绘画，但是毕加索其实是一个在写实方面特别有力量，或者说有特别深的根基的这样一个画家。只不过后来的人可能没有太多的去注意他早期的那样一些写实主义的一些作品。但我觉得就是这种跨领域的这种比较，其实也可以说明写实。我这里说的写实不完全是和讲故事等同的。其实对于一个作家的。 他的能力和他能创造出多么高的一个水准的小说是，其实是非常重要的一个因素。
So Just as the great painter Picasso, he did a lot of painting in abstractism in later stage of his life, which is very well known. But he is also very powerful in expressing or in his work of realism, which is less well known and probably ignored by people from later age. I made this comparison just to this literature world. Okay, it's your turn.
First of all, I'm happy to hear our Chinese colleagues because they're so deep, and what I hear makes me happy because they're combining classical approach with modern one, and that's how they're creating something new. Because these days in the world we have too much of the so-called postmodernism, in which you actually don't have a story.
那刚刚我也非常高兴听到我们中国作家也会进行一个比较，包括19世纪的一个相对传统的这个小说写作方法，还有我们当代的一个文学，当代的文学或者小说的这个写作方法。就通过这样的比较，我甚至我会觉得，也许我们现在经常提到一个后现代主义，其实在后现代小主义就很难是真正意义上的一种小说。
And somehow I feel that all of us who are present here, we still believe in the good story. And I couldn't agree more with my colleague, Mr. About what he said for combining fiction with poetry, combining the story and making it poetic. This is very important.
那就其实我们今天在座的作家，其实我想都是非常擅长讲故事的。那刚刚就是我们的同事黄帆老师也提到了，他其实既写小说又写诗歌。我觉得这两者的结合是很重要的，就是能够使你的故事具有诗意。Because
poetry is like music, and those are arts above everything else in art, and these are the highest aesthetics, the highest beauty. So when you make a story poetic, it will be like a perfect music.
所以我觉得诗歌其实像音乐，它是一种最高形式的艺术的美。所以我觉得，如果能够使小说变得有诗意，它就犹如音乐。What
I'm trying to say is, you have to have the combination of between essence, which is the story, with the form, which is the style. Because without the style, even you have the perfect story, it will still go down.
所以我觉得，所以我就会觉得应该把两者结合起来，就是把这个本质，也就是故事，和它的这个形式，也就是风格结合起来。因为如果没有好的这个形式，这个故事也会差强人意。A
story without a style is just plain journalism, and literature is always this combination between style and essence, so that the reader could be inspired, and when the writer writes, he or she has to somehow involve this spiritual code somehow in the text, as if it is a fine seal broidery.
所以我觉得，如果是没有好的形式，这个故事其实就像一篇新闻报道一样。那作为一个文学的话呢，它就应该既有好的形式，又有好的本质。那并且读者在阅读过程中呢，能够受到启发。所以我觉得作家其实就像把他们的作品、他们的灵魂精髓注入到他们作品当中，就像在刺绣一样。And
when the reader reads it, then he or she is basically unfolding to themselves this code and interpreting in their mind in their own way, which is also a process of creation, just like the writer did before.
所以其实读者在阅读的时候，他们也在这个过程中，在剧情展开的过程中，不断的去解读，不断的去注入自己的一些体验，然后这也是一种创作。And
I'm ending with that. So this is the magic of it.
这就是文学的一种神奇之处。Svetlana
was right. I agree with him. He said everything. But I studied Film and Literature Academy, and we learned there that in the world exist only about 30 stories. The other stories are only modified from this 30, maybe 50. Some optimistic that 60. No? So I think that the construction of story is not so important. Most important is personally view on life, on situation, on world, and feeling, emotion, and
那就我本身的话，我当时我是学习电影、学习文学的。那个时候我们就学到，其实世界上呢，只有这么几十个故事，其他的无数的故事都是基于这几十个故事进行调整的。可能有三五十，也许你乐观，你可以说有六十个故事。但我觉得结构并不是最为重要的。 最为重要的是你对你的观点，你对生活、对世界的观点，以及你的个人情感。
And my personal experience is that the readers like sincerity. When an author is down to earth.
那其实我作为一个读者，我的个人阅读体验告诉我，我最欣赏的是作家的一个真诚和他们的接地气。
When he admits he's not perfect, and he feels lonely when he shows that the hero is not always a positive tone, but that also has dishonest intentions and commits dishonest deeds.
那就是他当着作家，他承认他自己并不是完美的。他有时候他会感到孤单，他也会不诚实，他也会做一些错事。
I teach students now creative writing, and I say that the form and content must be in balance, you all said it. But that the student should only say and write what they think, what they feel, and what they themselves would enjoy reading.
那我本身呢也会去教授创意写作这门课程，我也是跟学生强调要在形式和内容上取得一种平衡。你们应该去对你们的思想、对你们的情感去写作，而且去写作你们所喜欢阅读的那种。
Thank you.
Mm. 我很高兴这个坐在我旁边这个同行。 跟我有一项工作很像，我也是在大学教创意写作课，非常高兴。I'm
very glad that I'm also teaching creative writing in university, just as our previous writer.
但是我忘掉了刚才没有提的第二个问题了。就是如何抓住一个想象中人物的微妙感情，并且转化为故事细节。
应该这样，我刚也同意这个综艺的一个说法，其实小说是跟人很像。比方说，我这个人相对是比较沉默的，其实我在生活中间很沉闷，不太说话，所以我的小说人物往往也是这样，不太会去过多的渲染心理活动。我觉得那种心理活动的过多的渲染会让人丢失掉神秘感。那么我们在阅读小说的时候，你会发现，当一个人物 你提供有限的心理活动的时候，他有更多的行为和情境中间的这样一种反应的时候，那你会发现这个人物他会牵动你去了解他。这个跟在生活中间是一样的，在生活中间如果你发现一个人什么都对你说了，你就不想了解他了。当你发现这个人少言寡语，你反而真的想去了解他。可能这个我觉得是跟小说中间的人物是一样的。
I think that novels are like people. I myself am very quiet in life. I don't say a lot of things. And my characters in the novel are also kind of quiet. They don't say a lot of things. And my novels are not heavy on psychological depiction. I think it would lead to a loss of sense of mystery. So if we if I only give certain amount of depiction of the psychological status, I think the behavior or the response of the character will be more intriguing. You are encouraged to find more about them. But I wouldn't go as far as the great writer Mr. Hemingway, because in his works there's basically no depiction of psychological status. There is a character's behavior and their conversations, but still the reader can get the sense of the psychological of the character. I think in that sense, he's truly a master.
If I 因为他的心理他也提供，他的这种人物的动作，他的各种活动他也提供，但是呢，你会发现他的心理部分是非常具有隐喻的这样一个色彩，依然会给你一种神秘感。
So one of my idol is Nabokov. I think
American writer.
Yes.
He writes about the psychological status and also writes about the behavior of his character. I think that even though he writes about the psychological status of his character, but it's still there is great sense of mystery.
So, 牵引读者往下这个了解故事发展的这样一个驱动力，所以我觉得有限的这种情境也是非常有用的一种方法。So
earlier I mentioned situations sometimes constitute my stories, so I think sometimes situation can also get the readers intrigued to find out how the story unfolds.
So
my next question is that when and where do you get inspired for your stories?
我们像那个做那个接力游戏一样，做。Okay, thank you. I am finding inspiration in the world around me, in my family. And in life of my friends, girlfriends, partners, they never can read what I am writing, and they never read it. And you know, I don't need inspiration. What they did. What they said, but for me is really most important what I feel about this situation, who I can imagine with the people who I know. Understand me? It's very terrible to explain it in English, what I mean. Maybe I will read it because I wrote some sentences about it. about my inspirations.
那您说到我的灵感，其实我的灵感大多数就是在我的周围的生活当中，在我的家庭，或者是我的朋友他们的生活。那他们，我的家人或者是朋友，其实很少读我的写作，他们也不需要读。但我也并不是特别的需要灵感，但是我主要是会关注我对于周围的场景或者人们的所作所为，我关注我自己的感受是怎样的。
Sometimes, my friends anger me, you know, and so I settle score with them in my story. But I don't kill of them or beat them, but I shun them in a clever way. My negative heroes are often betrayed in love, forgotten in old age, and are ridiculed by the media.
那其实有的时候我的朋友会生我的气，因为我在一些作品中我会给我的朋友找些麻烦，虽然我不会打他们，也不会怎么样他们，但是我会用一些比较有趣的方式去羞辱他们。
And inspiration is coming to me in the night when my house is quiet. I am alone in my room, and I am looking on the wall. Sometimes on the wall I have TV, but it doesn't matter. I'm only looking. And the inspiration sometimes will come.
那其实我最有灵感的一个时间段应该是晚上，那时候我的家里面非常的安静，我孤身一人，有的时候我会盯着墙看，那有的时候墙上还有电视，开着电视，但其实电视并不重要，我就是不断的盯着，然后就会有灵感。And
the inspiration must come when I have contract.
当然，如果我有这个写作合同或者写作合约在身的时候，我是必须要有灵感的。
Then I have to write in a day.
甚至我需要一天就要写出文章来。
Because it's my job.
因为我有合约在身，这是我的工作。
Thank you.
我会觉得作家其实都是有些怪癖的人，因为特别正常的人，我觉得不会。
So I think there's always something strange, something weird about a writer. I think normal people cannot make it as a writer, even though we look normal.
刚才我和那个作家黄凡，我们在下面喝咖啡的时候，我们就下聊天。他说他写作的时候。 整个一层楼面都不能有人，哎呀，我说我比你好一点，我这个一个房间没有人就可以，他要清楼，清楼层。
So earlier when we were waiting for this session, I had a coffee with Mr. Huang Fan, and we were talking about our strangeness. Huang Fan mentioned that when he writes, there shall be no one in the building. And I said that I'm better, I just need a clear house.
会有的作家可能就是说他一天要喝12杯咖啡才能写作，有的作家要在特别安静的地方，有的作家没有声音就不能写作，就是他用各种各样很奇怪的方式呈现出来。So
for some writers, they have to have 12 coffees in a day in order to write. Some write with quiet environment, some cannot write without sound. So there is always some kind of strangeness.
我会觉得作家其实和，他一般都很敏感，敏感的在一个阶段就是过敏，过敏的再一个阶段就是神经质，神经质再高一个阶段就是精神病，他肯定是在一个他的精神强度和他的敏感度都是和常人会有不一样的地方。 然后他用种种的生活的细节和习惯来习性来体现出来，所以你要概括成一个一定是怎么样的，我觉得这没法概括，也没有太大的意义，因为每个人是不一样的。
So for writers, for sure, they are very sensitive, and sometimes they go so far as to be neurotic, and sometimes psychological partially ill. So there is a level of sensitivity that is different to normal people, and this sensitivity can be represented in different details in their life.
所以有时候，比如说我面对我的同行，或者这个人不是很熟悉，怎么样的时候，我跟他说话的时候，我就可能会看着他，哎呀，我说，哎呀，你不要装啦，其实我知道你是谁，你真正的是谁，其实我是知道的，特别是好作家，好作家一定是在某些地方是有问题的，咱们有问题，我们接下来再讨论。So
I said that writers are very sensitive, so sometimes when I meet with someone that are not familiar with, I would say that don't pretend to be someone else. I know who you really are. I can feel it. So there is always some kind of strangeness in a writer.
Okay, who you are?
You never know. This is the, you know, life is search of like who you are after. I mean, if you just say this is me, you might be wrong.
其实人的一生都在找寻那个真实的自己，就如果现在你说你已经知道你是谁了，你很可能这是错的。
And it's the same with inspiration, because inspiration is it's like the muse or like woman's heart that comes and goes.
其实灵感也是这个样子，你的灵感它也是在来来回回，来来去去。
Also, inspiration is something which is so much desired by writers. But I remember an old Buddhist saying that there is pain because there is desire.
但其实，对于所有的作家来讲，他们都非常的渴望灵感。但我也听说佛家有一个说法，如果你有欲望的话，你就会有痛苦。And
that's how sometimes inspiration could lead you the wrong way if you do not apply some amount of self-limitation to it.
就所以说，如果你在追寻灵感的过程中没有自我约束、没有纪律的话，那它可能会把你带偏。And
by that, what you are doing is like you are kind of outcasting your mind, plots or stories that are already written. This is something important which Halina said, this is absolutely true, that in the world there are basically this and that amount of stories that are already played thousands of times.
而且刚刚我们的著作家也提到了，有我们只有这么几十种非常原创独特的故事，其他的都是在这些故事上的一些调整。
So it's basically like you go fishing and you draw the small fish back to the water. You just wait for the big one.
所以在就像钓鱼，如果你钓来只是一条小鱼，你可以把这个鱼重新放生，然后等待大鱼的来临。And
finally, I also like Halina. I like the inspiration and this loneliness at night. But at the same time, with the feeling that I'm not writing for myself, but for people whom I cannot see right now, but I feel them somewhere in the distance, in the distance of distance and time, and this is something which is, kills your loneliness.
然后刚刚呢，何琳达她也提到了，她通常是在晚上孤身一人的时候去进行写作。那所以其实我也会有这样的感受，但是呢，我会觉得我并不是为我自己写作，我是为那些我可能并没有看到的人，我并不认识的人，为他们写作。如果你有这种使命感，就不会觉得那么孤单。我发现这个都是创意写作课上回答的问题。 我再回答一下，我对灵感的一个态度是既相信又不相信。我先讲相信的这一面。那么平时我因为相信灵感，所以我喜欢走路， 跑步。那么我去上课的时候，一般都是坐地铁，我故意不骑自行车。那么每次上课的路上会走一个小时，整整一个小时。那我就发现我在走路的过程中间有无数的灵感，所以呢，每次一到教室或者一回家，我赶快把它记下来啊。所以光这样一个本子就每年就会记很多啊。另外我还有一个发现，就是越是忙的时候，你灵感特别多。越是忙着你特别想写作，但是没有时间写作，这时候灵感极多啊！一旦闲下来，你没有灵感啊，所以是这样一个。所以呢
，So this is also a question fairly frequently asked in creative writing courses. I would like to answer this question yet again. So for me, inspiration is something that I believe and I disbelieve at the same time. For the part of believing in inspiration. I think I myself like to run or walk. Sometimes it takes 1 hour for me to get to my school. And during this commute time, I would sometimes get inspired and I would note them down. So for 1 year, I would have many notebooks of my inspiration. Another thing I found out is that when you are busy, you are full of inspirations. You are busy, you don't have to write, but you are full of inspirations.
所以在这个时期呢，就是很多作家是为没有灵感而痛苦，我是因为有灵感而痛苦。
So some writers struggle with the lack of inspiration, but I struggle with too much inspiration.
我下面再讲，我不相信灵感的这一面，是因为我虽然是一个诗人，但是我大部分的生活是一个小说家的生活。所以我过的是极有纪律的一种生活，我每天上午一定是写作，为了写作我把大学的课程全部推到晚上上。
So for the next part, the reason that I do not believe in inspiration, well, I actually am a poet, but for the most part, I live as a writer, and I live a life of great discipline. I write in the morning, and most of my classes are happening at evening.
因为以前我了解到海明威、格林、托马斯曼，他们都是从早上9点写到中午1点钟。我当时不明白他为什么一定要这样做，但是我后来自己做了以后，发现这里面确实有道理。
So, as far as I know, a lot of great writers they write from 9 a.m. in the morning to 11 o'clock at noon. At the very beginning, I don't understand why they practice this way. But after I did it, I come to realize that there's a great sense to it. It makes sense.
20年前，我刚开始这么做的时候，花了半个月时间坐在电脑跟前，每天9点钟做，没有灵感，然后一片空白。但是我坚持做了半个月，开始就发生了一个巨大的变化。
I started this practice of writing at 9 a.m. in the morning 20 years ago. But for half a month, I was sitting in front of my computer, but nothing happened. There was no inspiration at all.
因为生命这个造物其实真的是很神奇的。大概从半个月开始，我就发现只要9点钟一坐下来。思如泉涌，然后应接不暇，然后就开始能写了，然后一直写到现在，所以我就觉得这个时候我不需要灵感，我坐下来就有灵感，所以我过去是要靠收集灵感，但这个时候你只要给我一个很小的一个说法，我就能开始写作。
So I think life is very magic. After half a month, after half a month, I started this practice. I got a lot of inspiration coming to me. In the past, maybe I have to collect my inspiration here and there. But now, whenever I have even a small idea, I can write.
所以早期我收集灵感呢，主要集中在一些具体的意象上面，具体的一个小故事的触动。但是到了后期，我所谓的灵感的收集，主要是在一个。故事的隐喻或者预言这个层面，有了这个东西，其实细节的构造、形象的构造，对我来讲已经不是特别难了。
So at the very beginning, I will write with things that are concrete. But Later, I got on another level from the metaphor point of view. So when I got back, when I got to that stage, writing details is not so difficult for me anymore.
That's all.
黄凡刚才说的时候，我突然想到那个毕飞宇有一句话，我觉得跟你是蛮呼应的。他说，其实当你不知道怎么写的时候，这个故事怎么往后发展的时候，你就很专注的看着它，就像看着一个深渊，然后你可能看个一小时还是不行，然后你一直一定是会有一个结果出来。我曾经这么，我觉得是很有道理。有时候你会觉得这个故事或者这个线索没法进行下去的时候，你专注的看着它，你可能就看了一个月，然后这个过程就出来了。这是一个写作很神秘的地方。
So what Huang Fan said also reminds me of another idea from another writer, Bifei Yu. He said that sometimes when you are blocked, you don't know what to write, you just keep looking at it at a piece, maybe after 1 hour, several hours, even a month, then something will come out of it.
好的，现在我们的第一环节到这里就告一段落了。我相信我们在场的读者朋友呢，一定有很多问题想要请教四位作家或者请教其中一位。大家如果有问题，请举手。Q&A
session, the floor is open to us.
这位读者需要话筒。我就不用英文提问了。我想就是特别想请问一下黄帆老师，因为您是诗人嘛，我很想问你一下，在当代生活中，你是怎么样理解诗歌精神的？我曾经在一个 一本诗集的序言当中看到这个问题，然后一直想了很久，竟然正好遇到一位在现实中遇到一位诗人，我想听听您的解答。
So my question is my question goes to Huang Fan, and my question is, what's your understanding of the spirit of poem?
我觉得这是一个特别好的问题，因为诗歌精神其实对20世纪以来的这种文化是特别重要的。 因为我们进入现代社会以后，其实我们的精神进入了一个悖论时期，因为人性中间的这种反复无常，可以说达到了一个极限。因为我们这种社会高度的这种发展，使得这种矛盾，就是我们因为人有两面性嘛，所以达到了一个极限。所以这个时候，我觉得诗歌是一种特别好的一种解脱方式。
It's a great question, especially in modern times, 20th century. There is a great sense of paradox in people's spirit, the freakness and the contradiction in people's spirit.
所谓的诗意就是，当你面对现实的时候，它能够让你暂时的飞离它，找到它的一个彼岸。 其实我们每一个事物中间都有诗意，比方说一个杯子，可能很多人觉得杯子没有诗意的，但是其实杯子里面有彼岸，你是可以找到诗意。因为我其实写的一本书，就最近这好像这里面也有叫月亮已失眠，我写了很多什么苍蝇、蚊子、汤勺、碗，我在这里面都找到了这个所谓的彼岸，然后你会发现这些日常的烟火气很重的东西里面其实 都有诗意，那诗意它来自于什么呢？来自于一个人对于这个事物的凝视，来自于一个诗人对事物的凝视。其实它是来自主观的，不是说所有的事物里面本身包含着诗意。
So earlier I mentioned that in the modern society there is a lot of great sense of frequentness or contradiction in people's spirit, and I think a poem is one way out of that. And I think you can find a sense of poem in basically everything. In one of my book, Sleepless Moon, I use a lot of everyday objects. Such as bow or spoon, and I think you can find a sense of poem in everything, and it's subjective.
所以这也是为什么我说，其实我们可以为小说带来诗意，因为小说虽然是写那种烟火气很重的那种生活啊，但其实这里面取决于你如何去凝视它，是可以凝视出诗意的。
So that's why I said that you can bring a sense of poem to the novel, even though the novel is something that is down to earth, but it also depends on how you look at it.
Oh, 我也想请黄帆老师，因为我也是个老师，然后我是个刚入门的文学老师，然后我想问，我觉得您很多的想法，通过你今天聊的，我觉得关于您创意写作教学的东西，你有没有考虑像毕老师一样，做一些这样的整理或者出版一些什么样的教学方面的东西？我觉得会是对我们老师非常好的指导。
So my question also goes to Huang Fan. I'm also a new literary teacher, so I was wondering if you have any plans to publish some books on how to teach creative writing.
也问得特别巧，去年夏天在南京只有两个作家面对社会开了这个创意写作课，毕飞宇开了一个小说课，我开了一个八堂写作课。那么后来毕飞宇那个呢，他是出了一本书，我呢因为比较懒，到现在没整理出来，但是已经有两家出版社在要，可能再过一年会出版，谢谢。
So it just so happened last summer I studied a course on how to write. It's an 8-section course. I've been kind of slow in have this framework for this book, but two publishing houses are contacting me, so hopefully next year you will see it published.
喂，黄帆老师你好。因为我看到你，因为感到很激动，有点语无伦次。因为我也是个诗歌爱好者，因为已写了很多年的吧，我是个餐饮行业的，但是呢，就是你说的，我非常的赞同，就是越忙的时候，诗来的灵感越多。就是当我有一天我的客人都在的时候，我在做那个花生米，因为都是特色小吃嘛，然后差点失火了，因为那个灵感很多的时候，我就坐下来写，完全忘了锅里边的花生米。当那个花生米变成黑豆的时候，我的诗也写好了，但是花生米废了。还是有一天我又在写的时候，越忙灵感越多，当我在写的时候，那个锅着火了，是我邻居对面的老板把它关了，又是一个卖肉的老板把它关了，他说不得了了，他说这火起来了，我说差点完蛋了。是的，所以说我相信你讲的，今天我好有感触，坐在那里，今天我有时间，我坐在这里好好写文章，结果是一片空白，根本就写不出来任何东西，因为那个灵感后来感觉也可以捕捉到的。谢谢黄帆老师。
So he's also he's speaking to Huang Fan. She is also a big fan of poem, and she works in food and beverage industry. So she just agrees with Huang Fan when he said that when you are busy, there is more inspiration. And then she cited some anecdotes of her working life. Because one day when she was cooking, when there was a lot of guests in her restaurant, and she was cooking, and then all of a sudden she got inspired, she got some inspiration, she started to create works, and then it got overburned.
Yeah, I have a question for Halina, because I know you are a scriptwriter, and I like script too, but I'm wondering that, like, what's the difference, or like, what are you going to pay special attention when you're writing a script, because script is different from a story, because it has characters and it has conversations, but story is more casual, so what are you going to pay special attention to when you are writing a script?
那这个问题是提给这个哈丽娜的，因为她本身也是个剧作家，所以就想问她，因为剧作家跟小说是不一样的，那她在写这个剧本的时候，她有什么特殊的专注点吗？
I spoke about it yesterday, but so you, I I love write books and I hate write scripts, but more money came from scripts. And it's a really very difficult work to do a good script. It's very difficult because it is the same as with novel, with prose. You have to know what do you want to say, what. But the form in script is the same line with important. You know, the form must be very clear. When do you want to tell everything about character of your heroine, your figure, you must tell it very short and with picture. So you paint, you are not only writer, you are painter and together. But not only writer and painter, you have to know everything from beginning to the end, like God. And then it is easy.
但是我本身非常热爱写书，我又痛恨写剧本，但是写剧本挣钱多，我也会写剧本。而且我觉得写剧本其实是非常难的一件事情，因为像小说或者是散文，你只需要了解你要说什么。但是对于剧本而言，你不仅有这个台词，你要而且这台词要非常的清晰明了，同时还要有很好的一个画面感。 所以你同时就像既是作家，也是画家，然后你还要自始至终了解这个故事的动态，了解一切，就像上帝一个视角一样。下一位读者，还有读者想要提问吗？
Any other questions from the audience?
So, when do you write? I think he talked about how he writes in the morning, but what is your writing style like?
There was a question.
Oh, sorry, you guys.
然后，因为刚刚黄帆老师也提到了他这个从早上九点开始写作的这样的一个习惯，所以就想问一下其他作家，他们有没有具体的写作时间？
I think I mentioned I was referring to write at night.
So I myself, I'm kind of low on IQ in the morning. It's like 60% of my full capacity, so I have to write at night.
And you said that you don't know why so many writers are writing through night. Yes? Yes, and I can tell you why.
然后我就知道为什么这些作家喜欢晚上写作的。Because
I am living with my family, and my grandmother need my care in day. My 90 years old grandmother needs my care. My grandson needs my care. My son needs to eat. My daughter when she is closing the door, I'm afraid that the house was down, you know, the quiet, I'm quiet and alone only at night, maybe sometimes with cake.
就是刚才我为什么会在晚上写作呢？因为白天的时候我需要照顾我的家人，我的祖母已经90岁了，我要照顾她，我也要照顾我的孙子、我的儿女，所以我只有在晚上的时候才真正有属于我自己的时光。也许有的时候会家人一块蛋糕。
我补充一点，其实我一开始是晚上写，半夜写，但是最后发生了一个很严重的问题，就是失眠。我大概有4到5年时间是严重失眠，失眠到什么地步呢？白天看到别人睡得精神抖擞，我很妒忌，啊，所以我就不愿意看他们。那么后来这个问题怎么解决？我就把时间改到了上午，然后改到上午以后，我的失眠症就完全消失掉了。我想说的是，其实。 你选择什么时段写作，这个其实是没有一个固定的。但是关键是你坚持在那个时间定点定时的写，它就会产生很神奇的效果。你也可以下午，啊，就像朱文颖，他晚上，我觉得朱文颖很强大，晚上他不失眠。像我不行，我只能上午写作。不是，
这个我也要补充起来。
So I would like to add that. When I first started to write, I usually write at night, but then I suffered from this insomnia for 4 to 5 years. So during the day, I got really sleepy, but I see people around me are very energetic, so I got jealous. That's why I try to switch my time of writing to the morning. So, and also Mr. Zhu Wenying said that she writes at night, but she does not have the problem of insomnia, so she's much stronger.
我其实和你一样，我失眠，可能有七八年了，我也失眠。我对于这个问题，我会觉得人是不是分成一种是早上的，一种白天的动物，一种是晚上的动物，这可能也不仅仅是作家，作家因为他就是一个职业习惯嘛，有的是晚上写作，或者说是有的是白天写作，但是我觉得常人可能也是分成这样两种。
So I've been having the problem of insomnia for 7 to 8 years. But I think just like an average person, some are morning person, some are evening person, so are the writers.
其实我会有时候会很疑惑，作家是不是应该是一个特别有一个像钢铁一样意志的人，然后我就一定要去改变我的时间和我自己的。 生命状态，我来写作，或者说我就是一个更偏近于艺术家的人，这是我一直我会觉得我很困惑的一种东西。比如说，就是在厨房要快要着，就是那种在正常和不正常的临界点上，还是我是有强大的意志力，我来控制这个东西的。所以我现在怀疑我和王黄帆可能是两类不同的人类。
感觉好累。
And also, I sometimes get confused. Whether writers should be someone with strong will, that they have to fit into a certain style, fit into a time frame. So I think that's also confused me.
但是有一点我可以确认，我觉得在写长篇小说的时候，有一点特别重要，就是作家的体能。所以为什么作家有时候你到了一定的年龄以后，你就是当你体能跟不上的时候，你一定会影响到你创作的质量。 这是非常有意思的一个事情，好像有人做过一个实验，当一个作家，我不知道这是半开玩笑还是真的，就说当一个作家写作的时候，他旁边放一个灯还是一个蜡烛什么的，说是那个他焕发的那个脑力能把那个东西自动的点燃，我觉得这好像有点夸张，但我就想可能是真实的，因为他肯定有一种能量，我们看不到的。 我们所谓的灵感，或者说有一些精神性的一种，有时候潜意识被唤醒的时候，我觉得是一种能量。我相信这个世界是有能量的。So
for novel, especially long novel, the physical energy, the physical strength, is very important to a writer. If the physical strengths do not catch up, then the quality of their works will suffer. So I hear this interesting thing that sometimes when the writers write, if there is a light or a candle next to him or her, the light or the candle will be lit up because of the brain power of the writer. I don't know, I think it's a little bit exaggerated, but I think there is some certain sense of trueness in it. I believe there is such thing as energy.
所以我会觉得一切的作家或者艺术家，他只不过用一种物质的形态，把宇宙中的这种能量，用一种能量化的或者你看到的方式呈现出来，他只不过是一种使者，可能是一种神秘的使命吧。我刚才突然想到这个问题。
So I think writers or artists just transform the energy in universe into something concrete.
I only want to say that in our country, is saying that the writer must be strong in this art, you know, because he's sitting and writing, so I'm strong.
所以其实我也是有听到这种说法，就是作家他的心一定是非常的强大的，因为你要不断的去做着去创作去书写，所以我其实也是非常的强壮。我们还有其他读者需要写几封。这位读者，
你好，我想问黄欢老师一个问题。 就是刚刚您在那个回答中多次提到了诗意，还有神秘感这个东西，就是我想知道你是不是你认为就是写作这个东西，非常需要这个东西，非常需要神秘感和诗意，然后以至于能让读者去对这个作品更加感兴趣，就是你为什么非常注重这个东西，想知道。So
the word sense of poem and sense of mystery have been reoccurring in Huang Fan's talk. So I was wondering if that is very important to your writing to keep the readers involved and intrigued.
这样好不好？就是我先回答一下，然后也让这几位作家都回答一下，好吗？不要变成我的独白了。
So the question also goes to all of the writers. I will answer first.
其实这你刚刚提的这个，其实是文学和科学的一个区别。科学就是说它是非常理性的，它是可以有一个确定的目标，甚至追求唯一的答案。它几乎没有神秘感。但是我们这个世界上，我们对科学的这种信念，其实是基于我们认为我们有足够的理性。但是这是值得怀疑的。
The question also relates to the difference between art and science. So science is rational, and we are setting up a specific goal. We're even looking for an only answer to a question. But all this assumption is based on the fact that we need to have enough rationality, which is questionable.
即使科学到了20世纪，也出现了不确定性，比方说。 量子力学里面的测不准原理，比方说20世纪末出现了混沌学，也就是说我们天气预报你不可能有长期天气预报，你永远不会预见会发生什么事情。But
now we've come to the 20th century, there is also a great sense of uncertainty in science. For example, in quantum physics or in the theory of chaos, we can never predict what exactly is going to happen.
而文学恰恰它最擅长的是面对神秘世界，面对我们生命中间的那些奇迹、那些灵性，这些东西呢是不可能用理性穷尽的，它是我们的直觉，它是我们的感性，它是我们的潜意识。But
for literature, it is good at dealing with things that are mysterious, things that are spiritual, and things and also other miracles. So this depends on our intuition.
它有点像中国那个佛教里面的禅宗，它强调它在某种程度上它是依靠的某些顿悟，甚至某些瞬间的顿悟，对这个世界的理解不是说我们理性可以完全的把握的，有时候要靠一些顿悟，直觉性的顿悟。 而文学它提供了很多这样一些顿悟的时刻，比方说你遇到一句很好的诗句，它提供的那种诗意就是一种顿悟。比方说一个短篇小说，它给你的某种启迪就是一个顿悟。一个小说中间所含有的那种隐喻，含有的那种预言。 它就是一些顿悟啊，这些东西我觉得是对我们二十世纪来讲是非常重要的，因为它能够让我们在面对这么一个复杂世界的时候，我们有一种瞬间的解脱。
So in Buddhism, there is this moment, there is this moment of awakening, this aha moment. But so it means that rationality cannot do it all. We need literature, we need a sense of poem, and also the inspiration, the metaphor in literature to give this, to give us this aha moment, especially in the complicated society or the time that we are in. So,
诗歌它是追求多义。追求这种奇异，这里面就包含了很多的神秘，不可穷尽。
So there is a great sense of mystery and inexhaustible in poem. 所以，since in our discussion, we mentioned the sense of poem and the sense of mystery. So why do you think it is so important to keep the readers involved or engaged or intrigued?
我会举一个例子吧，就是来对应这样的一个问题啊。比如说现在有一个，比如说机器人写作，以后人工智能，它可以在模仿就是小说的结构、语言，甚至说现在人工智能能够模仿小说人物的情感，我觉得这些可能都没有问题。但是这种神秘性，这种不确定性，这种潜意识的东西，我觉得在智能领域，人工智能领域，它是永远没有办法被抵达的。就是这个也是我觉得是一切文学和写作的起源和最终要抵达的地方。他要知道这个东西，就是英语叫 explore， 这到底是什么？我要知道，他不断的这样深挖下去。那我相信如果一个再高等的一个人工智能一个机器人，像刚才我身边的这位外国这位朋友，他说我很同意你说的这个蜡烛可以被点燃，我觉得机器人不可能点燃这个蜡烛。这就是人类，我觉得这是人类真正区别于一切的高等的这种智能生物，或者说我们还不知道的，甚至是外星人。我觉得如果说是因为这个世界太浩瀚了，我觉得人类的唯一性可能就是在这里。有时候我们自己也不了解自己的，让自己大吃一惊的也是在这里，因为有太多的可能性，这是文学要探索的东西。
So I would like to say that, especially now, we hear about AI, robotics all the time, but I think that, in terms of intuition, subconsciousness, or sense of mystery, those are the things that's without the reach of AI or the things alike. I think literature can explore the more possibilities, and I think that AI or even aliens or some other intellectual beings, that's what set people apart from those.
Involved, attracted. Well, there are many techniques about this. Let me share just one. It's like having so many different stories going at the same time, but keeping in suspense. And at some point, these people start interacting with each other, and that is how the reader wants to read more and to find out more until at the end you don't tell the reader what exactly is going to happen between all these different plot lines. But you have to be careful with this because you it's like mathematics this way, because especially if you want to make a movie, if you do too many of that, you might go wrong. don't make it too complicated, that's what I mean.
吸引读者或者使读者继续去不断的阅读的一个方法，对我来说，就是要保持一定的悬疑性，一定的神秘性，然后呢，通过人们之间的这个互动不断的展开，然后使读者阅读更多。但是，通过这样的不同的故事线，还有一些悬疑的线索来保持读者的兴趣。但是对于电影来说，也要保持谨慎，也不要使用太多，不要将其做得太复杂。
否则可能会出问题。好，就提最后一个问题好吗？最后一个读者提问。然后我想问一下那个朱文莹朱老师，就是写小说的时候，如何才能能采那个观怪，让读者与之共鸣？ 就是用简单的文笔让读者与之共鸣。用简单的语言。
How to make when writing stories, how to make it relatable to the readers with simple language or plain language?
How to make it
relatable to the readers, to the audience? Relatable.
首先你知道你是面对的什么样的读者，因为读者太多了。就像比如说我今天，有时候我会比如说一个活动，我会看着你的眼睛，我就知道我和你是不是可以有这个共鸣。其实有的人可能就是永远不可能有共鸣，就像我们在我们的朋友或者说是。 我们在婚姻朋友和父母，有时候我会有一些90后的朋友，他和他们的父母非常紧张的关系，他觉得父母完全不理解他，那这个时候你再努力其实是没有共鸣的，你先翻译一下对吧？So
in order to make your story relatable to your readers or to your audience, you have to know first. Who is your reader or your audience? But for me, I think that even now I'm attending this event, I can know if I can if there is any relation between us by looking at you. And I think this is also true in our family life, in our marriage, or in our friendship. But sometimes simply your vibes just don't click. So I have some friends who are born after 90s and they say that they have very tense relationship with their parents.
还有一点我会觉得作家至少在于我觉得不要太多的去考虑读者，因为你一个作家要做的就是尽可能真实而勇敢的 表达你自己，总有一部分人他可以懂得你。就像我们在我们的日常生活里，有两种可能，一个是你把真实的自己藏起来，你想取悦别人；还有一个是我就做真实的自己，有的人可能会讨厌你，但是最后的情况是一样的。这个世界上只有一半的人会喜欢你，所以还不如做你自己。
I think for writers, you don't need to think about readers too much during the process of writing. And the important thing is to express yourself in an authentic and brave way. There is always readers who can understand you. I think that just like in real life, some people pleaser, they hide who they are, but some, they just be themselves and be hated by some others. But I think it's always half-half.
Not all people can will like you. 如果这世界上所有人都喜欢你，我觉得这也是个trouble，这个绝对是有问题的。就是，所以就是，我觉得这个文学可能可以扩大文学以外的所有的这个领域，就是真实的、勇敢的做你自己，恰恰就是最难的，就想认识自己，做自己就是最难的。所以我们其实回到了。
So I think it goes beyond literature world that just be yourself, know yourself, and go back to the essence.
I mean, your answer expresses it all. So the short answer is just be sincere. I mean, don't pretend you're somebody else, and it's going to be relatable.
就刚刚也是非常同意中英老师所说的，就是不要假装是其他的人，做你自己。
That's it. Thank you.
那好的，由于时间原因，我们今天的第八场活动讲故事的技巧的培养就到这里就结束了。然后感谢大家的参与，也感谢四位作家与我们深刻的诠释了一些写作中的原理。然后大家如果有什么其他想要交流的，可以私下里再来问。谢谢大家今天到场，谢谢。